Okay, we're back. Getting back to the agenda, we have public forum, which is for non-agenda items only. So if there's anyone from the public that would like to speak, please state your name and address.
Yes, Jim Fitzpatrick, 9 Osprey Lane. I was here, well, not here, I guess I was upstairs 2 weeks ago, correct? And my issue at the time, my question at the time, was really a request of an update on what the status of the town administrator, and I think you replied to those questions at that time. And I asked at that time if we were operating in compliance with the town charter, specifically 4.5 of the town charter, and I left it at that. I want to preface the next comment that this is in no way has anything to do with the current acting town administrator. In fact, we've worked together many times. But my question is, as I was saying earlier, and I said last week, I'm very much a process guy. If we stay according to process, according to procedures, if we stay on the rails and off the ties, we're in good shape. When we tend to drift or interpret loosely, we can get ourselves in a bit of trouble. And according to the town charter, there is yet another paragraph that talks about vacancies. Now, 4.5 says you need to fill a vacancy, all right? But apparently, there is some question about what is a vacancy. Well, 4.5 says fill the vacancy. Section 10.3 of the charter, and I'll read it, if you'll forgive me, just so we move right along here. In addition to the other provisions of this charter, a vacancy shall be deemed to exist in any department, office, or board whenever an officer, member, or employee dies, hopefully not, resigns, or is removed for just cause, is permanently, physically, or mentally incapacitated, so forth, and so on. The key word here is resigns. Specifically, one word, no qualifier, nothing else. Now, the reason this matters is that, again, I'm not casting aspersions on the town manager. What I'm asking the town board to do here is start the clock moving. Now, it takes time to put together a search committee to replace it. All right? I recognize that. And we want to get the best qualified candidate we possibly can. But right now, we're kind of in limbo. We don't have a finance, a full-time, I guess we do. He is a full-time finance director. That's great. But we need to bring somebody in, at least in parallel, while Ed's still around, to catch up on this administrator job, because this is not an easy thing. Ed's going to leave. We may not have found our replacement administrator. The charter specifies, back in 4.5, that you've got, let me go to it to be specific, I think it's 30 days. Am I wrong? 30 days, folks. So something's got to give, and I don't think we're going to get a search committee together and start it on that in 30 days. So what I'm asking you to do is take another look at those two provisions of the charter. And if you're in agreement with me, I think you need to get after hiring an interim person, getting them in place, and then in a very orderly way, not a panicked way, go about the search committee. So that's my first message. Second one is, again, on that shortfall that just appeared that Mr. Angel pointed out, our budgets have been based in the past here a bit on those revenues, some of them from the dispatch center. We have an ongoing shortage. It's not just, in our assumptions. We're going to have to do some other adjusting somewhere to make up for that lost revenue. So some of those numbers look like a one-time error. Others are going to bear down on us for a bit, and it all adds up. Just thought I'd throw that in. Any questions? I thank you for your time.
Anyone else for public comment?
Just a quick, you like
yes.
To get up there?
Yes, please.
Russ Simon, 510 Cushing Road. On the 437, I don't know, I recognize you just became aware of that as a town council. I don't know when you're going to process that or discuss it. I also wonder how much the town council has gotten involved in actually looking and understanding the numbers, since we seem to have had a number of issues come up over the past several months between the surprise on the tax rate, how the Black Bear TIF was accounted for, double accounting for in revenue when I was in the budget committee meeting, full well knowing that we weren't going to have the dispatch fees anymore. So I guess my question is, how much does the town council get engaged in actually looking and understanding the numbers when they present them to the budget committee? And second, when do you plan on discussing what actions may be taken on the additional gap of $437,000?
I would believe that at our, possibly next week, because we are having another meeting next week, we may be discussing the actions that are being taken to try to alleviate the $437,000, to see if we can't make that up over the coming, 6 months we've got left to this fiscal year. We're also looking at a revenue analysis, which should be done in a couple of weeks. So those, that step's already in process, if I'm not mistaken, correct? But we will be discussing as a council ways to hopefully alleviate some of the cost that the revenues that we're not going to see.
Okay. Thank you.
Anyone else for public comment? Okay, seeing none, I'll close public comment at 8:59. Agenda item number one. Recommendation of Great Bay Municipal Coalition to formally request DES to collaborate with the Memorandum of Understanding and to undertake formal rulemaking action as it relates to nitrogen limits for Great Bay. Who is taking this lead? Is this going to be you?
Or? I'm going to start and Sean's going to help out.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you know, the current regulatory standards for water quality are set by DES. And those criteria are then eventually used by the EPA in establishing the permit limits that the town has. During the process of the establishment of the water criteria, the various communities who would be affected by it became involved in the process and began questioning some of the scientific standards as it related to how they were arrived at. And part of what they sought to have the DES undertake was a scientific peer review for that regard. In fact, they also requested DES to formalize the standards through the administrative rules process that they're required to do, which would have then kicked in public comment and the scientific peer review. You may recall, I guess it was last year, we signed a, the community signed a memorandum of agreement with five other communities as it related to working collaboratively with DES to undertake the study in order to resolve some of the uncertainties with the DES nutrient criteria. Part of that process was a collaborative effort on both the state and the communities involved to undertake some testing specifically in the Swampscott River. And part of what the coalition did was we all pitched in some funds to do it because DES didn't have funds in order to undertake that study. To our surprise, when work was being undertaken last in August, we found that the EPA and the DES were out there undertaking studies, which was a significant duplication of effort, which would have saved us funds in that regard. We then requested through the Freedom of Information Act, through the our consultant, those reports so we could look at them in order to determine what they were finding to see how much they collaborated with us. Part of the issue that we have at the present time is that DES, as I mentioned, sets the water quality standards, and the EPA is relying on that. And at this point in time, they're saying, based upon DES's standard studies, is that a 3 milligrams per liter of nitrogen is what the communities need to reach. We have been making our arguments through the public hearing process to try to evaluate that to see whether it should be the standard that we should be held to, or more importantly, the 8 milligrams per liter standard with the approach of the adaptive management. We seem to be at odds because the DES doesn't even want to respond to whether or not the adaptive management process would work in the first 5 to 10 years of the running of a new plant. So what we have done at this point, the city of Portsmouth has undertaken a resolution that seeks to do three different things. And if I will, I'd like to read it. It says, to continue to work with the Great Bay Coalition through legislative and other means to, one, ensure that DES is required to conduct a formal rulemaking procedure which complies with state law, and to develop a sound scientific basis for the permit limits, to oppose any permit limit for a Portsmouth, which would be a Newmarket wastewater treatment plant that exceeds 8 milligrams per liter, and to pursue an adaptive management approach to the Great Bay estuary health. The council in Portsmouth passed this. I believe that Dover is discussing that this evening. And I would like to request the council to support this effort, so that way we can have a sort of continued unified effort on behalf of all of the coalition communities towards resolving the issue as to whether or not an 8 or a 3 is the best for the not only the town of Newmarket and our other coalition partners, but for the health of the bay. And I'd like to turn that over to.
Okay, can you just hold on for a second? You had a quick question?
Yeah, can I ask you a question? The letter that the city of Portsmouth wrote, it's about, you know, working with the DES. Is there any cost associated with all this? Nowhere in this package does it mention any cost.
At the present time, the answer would be no, because it's a continued effort with working through the legislative process. If you recall, we had met with Senator Prescott. Yep. And worked with him to.
So any cost, though, would be, if there are any costs, it would be part of the money we've already allocated?
Correct. And if there is something else, then we would obviously come back to the council and have a discussion as to what that is at this
okay.
point.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, there's some cost, at least to get to an 8, to go from what we currently have to a facility that would build the 8. That's a cost.
Yeah, no, I'm talking about just
the effort right now.
Working
with just to work with DES.
No, I'm not building the plant, just okay, to work right. with DES.
But the resolution they passed has going to an 8 in it, right? Obviously, they'd have to go through their whole, the
yes.
warrant article.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Can I discuss?
Sure.
How much have we spent out of that? I think we allocated 60,000. Is that close?
It was 50,000, I believe. It was 40,000 for the study and 10,000 for John Hall.
Okay. How much have we spent out of that, do you know?
I'd have to look at that to get the exact amount. I can get that back to you.
Okay. But that's what we're going to be using toward this?
That, the John Hall part, yes.
Okay. Because it's also hiring a law firm and at least...
Right, that's another discussion.
Okay. So. All right.
Okay.
Sean?
I think... the town administrator did an excellent job explaining how we've got here so far. I think the only thing I would like to add, the most important thing is that DES, like he says, New Hampshire DES, sets the water criteria, and the EPA uses that water criteria to set the limits for the wastewater treatment plants. However, the most important thing to realize is that the DES did not go through formal rulemaking process. And what that process is an independent peer review, and it's also public comment. So their process and their nutrient criteria didn't get any review from the public nor from an independent peer review. Why that is important? Because if you look at the fact sheet on our draft permit, everything in there stated by the EPA used that draft nutrient criteria. So by forcing them to go through the process, it actually stops the EPA from using that data. And it allows us to look at that data on science-based to make sure that we're doing it science on a science-based process. It's not just, here it is, you know, go do it. I think that's really important. We want to make sure that we're doing these things because the science says we should be doing these things. And I really think it's looking at some of the stuff that we did on that two-week data that we pulled out from our sampling. We had a draft report that was should have came out the first of the year. A lot of that data was presented to the New Hampshire DES showing that 8 is actually a good place to start for the nutrient criteria. And that would bring us back to pre-1990 levels of nitrogen in the bay, which in the night, why that is that important? Because in the 1990s, the eelgrass was doing very well.
So was the 8, I'm trying to remember from that night, the 8 level got us to 80% of the nitrogen removed, correct?
It removed around 80% of the nitrogen from what the facility was putting out.
Going
yes.
From 8. Okay, as opposed to 3. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I think I have two things, Sean. In the stuff I've been able to read about this, DES at this point in time is saying that they can't respond to the coalition because the coalition hasn't presented them anything. Now, I know you said we've given them draft information. When do we expect to have a final report that we're going to throw at them so that they can't say they don't have any information?
I haven't talked with John Hall, but that final report should have been to them by now. They should have that report. I'd have to check with them to see if they actually physically got it in hand.
Okay. And obviously not having seen that draft report, does that report bolster our case?
It does on transparency and a lot of the other, and DO, a lot of the issues that we were talking
about. What about nitrogen, which is the big issue?
Well, it bolsters that nitrogen, that it's dissolved in organic nitrogen, and that the wastewater plants, by removing 80%, going to an 8, reduces the nitrogen in the bay. That's what the data that John Hall is telling me.
Okay, that's the data we expect to have out of that report.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I think I've been working off a faulty assumption here. So you said that DES sets the criteria and EPA sets the limit?
EPA uses the criteria and sets the permit.
So does the criteria have, do you mind if I ask a couple of questions? So does the criteria have a number associated with it, or is it just the criteria? Is total nitrogen the criteria, and then a limit of like 0.8 or 0.3 placed on that via the permit from EPA?
Basically, the criteria says how much nitrogen should be in the waters, and then the EPA uses that amount that they're saying should be in the water to set their limit.
So the state told the EPA 0.3, and then the EPA gave us a permit for 0.3.
Well, basically they're saying DES says that there shouldn't be any more than 0.35 milligrams per liter of nitrogen in the river at any one time.
Right.
And then EPA sets a limit, a pounds limit, and a concentration limit on the treatment plant to meet that inline water criteria.
So the state's monitoring the water itself, and the EPA is looking at the wastewater treatment facility.
They're looking at a load, yeah. They're looking at the full load coming to the the waters.
All right, thank you.
Councilor Bergeron.
Mr. Chair, would you like some sort of a resolution or
motion?
A motion, thank you, for this? to draft a letter similar to Portsmouth's in regard to the Great Bay Municipal Coalition to formally request DES to collaborate with a memorandum of agreement and undertake formal rulemaking action as it relates to nitrogen limits for Great Bay.
Second. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, Ms. Winowski, will you call the vote, please?
Can I just ask one?
Go ahead.
So we send this to DES, mm-hmm. and they make what, a ruling as to whether or not they're going to accept it, or? Because maybe I missed something, but I thought, my understanding was that they were going to, we were going to start out with an eight. They were going to do, meaning for nitrogen, and then they were going to do consistent tests and see how that worked for Great Bay and if there was improvement.
That's what the hope was.
And that's off the table now?
A few months ago, that's off the table. EPA has come out and said, you're going to go right to three.
Right. Okay, so that's the bottom line. There's no more interim.
Right.
And then.
This is trying to maintain an interim, trying to say.
Just telling them to follow the rules.
To DES that you did not follow the rules and regulations that you have to enact this. So please follow those rules. And if you do that, we think you will see that the three is not the right number, that the eight is the right number.
Okay.
Does that make sense? That's what this letter is.
And then the likelihood would be, if they don't accept, before I vote on it, I just want to leave.
Right, yep.
The likelihood would be that if they don't accept it, that we're going to be in litigation. Is that fair?
That's fair, that I would say we would at least threaten litigation, yes, to force them to follow their own rules.
And just for
they're not following their
rules. And just for the public's, you know, I think the difference was, what, 12, 13 million to 16, 17? Or
yeah.
Can you
give us?
Yeah,
it was $4 to $5 million.
12 and a half to 16.
Just so everybody kind of knows what. And I just had one more real quick question. On page 6 of that, you know, the criteria, and I just want to understand one thing. It says, what is the impact of the rate users, et cetera? And it said, the average sewer user's rate would be 2% of the median household income. That was, you know, they were, and I was trying to get a handle on what percentage does 2% equate to, Sean, if we have to, you know, get to the three? Because I don't know what the average median
income. The median household income is 58,000.
And that's what they're basing that on?
For us, for Newmarket, I'm saying is 58. I don't know what Portsmouth is.
I didn't see that anywhere.
This is a Portsmouth. That's a Portsmouth document.
Okay, so
ours
for
is
Newmarket, 50, it's 58?
58,000, correct.
Okay, so it's 2% of 58 grand is what you're
correct.
Really saying.
And, correct, unless you do an income survey of just sewer users, and then that could actually drive that number down.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So we'll send a letter, and then we just keep our fingers crossed. Is that basically the way it works?
Yep.
We hope
keep
they
pursuing.
Accept it.
Yep.
Okay, fine, thank you.
Any other discussion? Mr. Winoski, we call the vote, please.
Council Levy?
Aye.
Council Bentley?
Aye.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council Zink?
Aye.
Council Nazaro?
Aye.
Council Bodman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 7-0. Next up, I'm hoping will be a short discussion. Report on the establishment on water and sewer districts. You've received a lot of information in reference to that. It looks as though it's a lengthy process, to say the least. I would strongly recommend that this be something that the next council in March takes up as one of their priorities, one of their goals, is to either work on forming it or not forming it, one or the other. So if the council is good with that, any comments or questions?
I personally think it's something that we should pursue. Let the people that have water and sewer vote on those things that are going to impact them. So, but I agree it's something that we're not going to resolve now. Let the next council figure it out.
Okay. Item 3 is boiler insulation report. You should have that with your packet.
Mike, just the whole thing about Divine Millamed, is that we're not going to discuss any of that?
No, I'm just put that forward next Wednesday.
Okay, because I wasn't told it.
What was that?
The Dan Bisbee, the attorney.
Oh, okay. Mr. Winoski, we want to just go over the numbers quickly if you can.
I guess I'd like to update the council a little bit. First is on the boiler analysis, the cost for the fuel, which is oil and propane, are what the town uses at the current time of $3.48 for oil and $2.09 for propane what we currently paid in December. As I noted in past discussions, we use approximately 5,600 gallons of oil per year, and it costs us approximately $19,471 at the $3.48 cost. The propane for the boiler, if you see on the boiler analysis, is 4,550 gallons per year, and that's because the boiler runs on a modulation, and it uses enough propane to provide or modulate itself to heat the water that is necessary for heating the building, whereas the oil runs, it's either on or off. So therefore, the propane cost at $2.09 is about $9,510. As I indicated, if the council was to approve the purchase of two propane tanks of 1,000 gallons each, along with the installation of the new modulating boiler for propane, the payment period would be an 8-year payback. Secondly, I incorporated a request by Council Levy to determine what the R value is of the insulation in the town attic, and the gentleman who from MJW drywall and foam insulation walked the entire attic and indicated that in his opinion that it's approximately 10 in R value. He noted that it's compressed, it's sporadically applied, in some areas it's almost non-existent. He then provided for your review four different proposals as it related to spray insulation and blown-in fill cellulose. So, in addition, I also provided the council the prior insulation costs that we had received from the two other vendors that provided costs for that. So,
I have two questions. The first one, Ed, if you look at the boiler analysis of 1229, the very bottom line says the payback is 11 years. Is that's just a misprint?
Yeah, that's it. I noticed that this evening when I was going over it.
Okay. And the second thing is with the insulation, we have costs and what the R value would go to if we apply this insulation. Has there been an analysis done of what savings that would equate to?
I didn't have that done at this point. Obviously, it would have an effect to if we put in the boiler and put in the insulation and installed a new boiler. I'm sure that the payback would be lesser than 8 years. What that would be, I don't know at this point.
Can I ask one more follow-up? Mm-hmm. Are the insulation guys going to give us expected payback period for doing that?
I can request that.
Expected savings, I guess, that we'd have to calculate the payback period.
Yep.
I certainly would like to see that for the insulation. I mean, common sense would tell you that the insulation is going to save money, but I think we need to see how much. Thank you.
Mr. Winoski, the bids on the insulation is bid option 1, 2, and 3, but it's got a total of like everything. So generally when I see option 1, option 2, option 3, you pick one of them and that's what you do.
Correct.
Why is there a grand total of all three plus the 15-minute fire thermal coating? I mean, is that what I'm reading on this quote?
Correct. Each one is a separate one depending on what you want to do, and I don't know why he totaled it up because it would be necessary to do that.
Okay, I just want to.
We're not doing the whole thing.
Well, no, and that's what I wanted to understand because we had three different options to go with. So, okay, thank you. Councilor Bergeron?
Do we currently have funds set aside for building improvements that would cover something simple like just putting insulation in the attic?
We have
the money to available.
It would be my recommendation to take it out of the Building and Grounds Capital Reserve Fund in order to accomplish this.
Okay, because I would think insulation would be a simple and effective thing to do to a building.
Yes.
Just a couple of quick questions. I also wanted to know what the savings was regarding the foam, but the third option says 12 inches of blown and loose cellulose insulation to a depth of 12 inches. Our value is 38 for $4,600.
Mm-hmm. That's what
you quoted.
Okay.
Yep. Now, the second option was 5 inches of cell foam, and then what was the, and he was also going to do the exterior walls for $25,000?
Correct.
So there was no exterior walls in the third option?
Correct.
So we should really kind of know what the difference is there in savings.
And it's actually, it's cell foam as opposed to cellulose, the two.
Yeah, that's fine, but the R rating is actually better as far as the ceiling for $4,628, if this is right.
I agree.
So
that's not right.
Well, I'm just reading what it says.
But if you go to the actual contract, you've got to add the 12.6 to that. That 12.6 is missing from that option three.
Yeah, I mean, it says here, right. Our value is 38 at a cost of 4,600.
Yeah, that's
right.
That's really 17,500. Right. That 4,600.
You need to go to the actual contract.
Okay. Well, it would have been.
Yeah, that's okay. A mistake.
Okay. Well, that answers that question, because I was going to say go with that for the ceiling.
Right.
I would too. Well, that's what it said here, so I didn't.
When it's too good to be true, it is.
Anyway, I guess the question I have is, you know, if we do the ceiling and we do the walls, you know, what's the savings going to be versus just doing the ceiling? And then I've been told that we don't have much insulation throughout the building, like in the, for example, the town council chambers, et cetera. That's what I've heard multiple times. So if we do this in the attic, which I'm sure is going to have some benefit, how does that relate to the lack of insulation throughout the building in the walls? Has anybody discussed that with you, Ed?
I did have some discussions with Dave Walker, who used to be the in-town public works director. Mm-hmm. When they were doing the building, they had explored, from my understanding, the possibility of blowing in insulation. The problem is the way that the school is constructed, a lot of the walls have blocking in it for mm-hmm. the various chalkboards that were put up on the exterior walls, so it prevented them from doing that. Plus, they wouldn't be able, they'd have to drill into the plaster wall itself in order to blow the material in.
No, and I guess maybe
but
I'm not.
As on the outside, but when they put the ceiling in, they didn't put any insulation on the top of it.
And all I'm asking is, if we do this, is it going to make a demonstrative difference in the building where the walls don't have much insulation? That's just one question I would ask them, because it would be a shame to spend, whether it's 17,000 or 25 or whatever we do, if, you know, the attic is roasty toasty and the rest of the building is not getting the benefit. I mean, I just don't know enough about that, but I think it's worth asking. So that's my question. And obviously the last question is the timeline for the payback. Yep. Please. Thank you.
Councilman Mazzaro?
Yeah, I just had a quick question on the boiler analysis, and I don't think you're not going to be able to answer it right now. But so the payback period, or the break-even point of 7 years, it's assuming steady price for oil and propane, I assume just so that it's apples to apples.
Yep.
But my concern is that oil and propane don't, the prices don't change in direct relation to each other. So I think that if we don't look at this with a trend as to which increases quicker or which one's more volatile, then the analysis we're getting isn't really as accurate as it could be. It may be much shorter or much longer depending on which one is a more volatile fuel. Like, not volatile as in explosive, yep. But volatile as in price. So I think that if we had the ability to look back, maybe assuming the payback 7 years, maybe look at what the historic 7-year trend is for changes in price between heating oil and propane,
it probably
gives a more accurate assessment of what the break-even point is more likely to be.
And then you were going to get us the service on the boiler, like I think Mike had asked a few times. I'm sorry, Council, Chairman LaBranche had asked what the, you know, how much we've been spending on the boiler, just so we have an idea of what kind of yearly maintenance. Remember, you wanted to know how much we were spending to maintain it, because that was part of the picture. So maybe we could just see, you know, last year's service. You know, if we're dumping $3,000, $4,000 a year into it. That's nice to know.
Okay. Any other comments from the council? What do you want to do with this? Get these questions answered that we presented this evening?
By the time we get it, it'll be summer, so then we can...
Good time to do it.
...deal with it with the next council.
Okay. Next up is town council to consider appointments to committees and commissions. We have three people.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
What is the, what's your opinion on what, how many people we're going to put on this committee?
It's my understanding we were going to place two people. Is that correct?
I would suggest... We have three candidates, I think, are very qualified, reading the resumes. I think it's great. We struggle to get people to come out for committees, and it would really be a coin toss to say which one couldn't. I would suggest, especially in light of, you know, what's happened recently in the Energy Committee and people's life so busy and people being out, that I don't know that it would hurt anything to have three people. Just my own opinion on there as opposed to two. We have three people, I think, again, that have done some things, two of them some similar backgrounds with civil engineering, and I'm just throwing it out. Don't know what the rest of the council thinks. I know you want to keep committees fairly small, mm-hmm. but again, some of these people have their own businesses and have other committees they're on, and have, so it's not likely that at every meeting all three would show up maybe anyway, but... just throwing it out there. I don't know that it would hurt to have three different opinions and three different sets of eyes looking at this.
I would support that as well.
So, Councilor Bentley, would you like to make that as a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we have three people on the River
Dam Removal Study Committee.
The Dam Removal Study Committee, isn't it?
Dam Removal Study.
Okay, is there a second on that?
Second.
Any discussion by the council?
My only question would be that this is an official, this will be an official modification of the committee makeup.
Did we actually do a resolution on this one?
We did a vote on
resolution.
It.
It was five members.
We did a vote on it though, right?
Right. It was.
So I don't have a problem with that. I just want to make sure we go through the right process.
And then a couple of the River Study group and the Watershed Alliance.
So what was the total?
I just want to make sure we go through the right process. I think we do. I just want to make sure we go through the right process. I don't have a problem.
We're doing that by making a motion and a vote, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
Is it?
No, go ahead.
Is it a good idea to have an even number of people on the committee?
Well, no, it isn't. But once again, this is a committee that's just. Gathering the, it's an advisory committee.
Okay. You know, I'm less concerned if it's an advisory than it is.
They're going to present the information to the council, and the council will act accordingly.
Yeah. No, but if they take a vote, it could be a
3-3.
Yeah. Yeah, we run that risk. I mean, can I?
Go ahead.
I mean, I was the one that said I didn't think we needed a committee in the first place, but. The fact that we have three people from this town that want to be on this committee that all look qualified, I say, why not put them all on there?
And two of them that, from my knowledge, are first time.
Mm-hmm. And in my experience, civil engineers are brilliant people.
Oh, no.
What makes you say that, Councilor?
You don't have one on the committee.
I've dealt with a few of them.
Okay, we have a motion. We have a second. Is there any more discussion on it? Because if there is not, I will ask for a vote, which will make this committee a three-member at large committee. Mr. Winowski, call the vote, please.
Council Levy?
Aye.
Council Bentley?
Aye.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council Zink?
Aye.
Council Nazaro?
Aye.
Council Bottoman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranche?
Aye. Motion carries 7-0.
I think for the people at home, we've had a lot of discussion, but we haven't mentioned the names.
Well, I think we should still go through the process.
We're going to make a motion now for those.
Oh, okay, all right.
We should still do that and actually appoint them, yes.
Okay.
Counselor Bentley, you wanted to make a nomination?
Yeah, I want to nominate John Ramsey from Lang's Lane to be on the Dam Removal Study Committee.
Second.
Okay. Any other nominations?
I make a motion we nominate Chris Hawkins from Hawkins Drive to the Dam Removal Committee.
Okay, we have a first and a second. Are there any other nominations?
I'd like to recommend Michael Rory from Durrell Drive.
Second.
Okay. Any other nominations? Seeing none, Mr. Winowski, I'll ask to vote first on Mr. John Ramsey.
Counselor Levy?
Aye.
Counselor Bentley?
Aye.
Counselor Bergeron?
Aye.
Counselor Zink?
Aye.
Counselor Nazaro?
Aye.
Counselor Bonneman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 7-0. Next is the appointment of Chris Hawkins. Mr. Chris Hawkins.
Counselor Levy?
Aye.
Counselor Bentley?
Aye.
Counselor Bergeron?
Aye.
Counselor Zink?
Aye.
Counselor Nazaro?
Aye.
Counselor Bonneman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 7-0. Next is the appointment of Mr. Michael Rory.
Counselor Levy?
Aye.
Counselor Bentley?
Aye.
Counselor Bergeron?
Aye.
Counselor Zink?
Aye.
Counselor Nazaro?
Aye.
Counselor Bonneman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 7-0. I thank the three of you for putting your names in, and I'm sure someone will be in touch with you shortly. Or at least it's my hope. Okay. Geez, I'm sorry, Mr. Hawkins and Mr. Ramsey, you are here. Did you want to say anything? My apologies for not offering you the opportunity.
I'm just here to answer questions if you had any. I guess the biggest question is, do you have a formal charge to the, like a mission statement?
We don't, but I'll have Diane Hardy to be in touch with you and sit down and have a conversation with her.
When are we going to choose the rest of the committee?
There is no rest.
I thought it was the people at large.
There's people from the Rivers Advisory, and we haven't heard back from those yet.
Okay, so we don't.
This.
Yeah. What's the time?
We asked them to get back in touch with us as soon as possible for the recommendation.
Okay.
Okay, next up is Town Administrative Search Committee. What I have here, Mr. Winowski, if you could pass those down to the two counselors. I have some information that I've received over the last couple of weeks outlining in this packet. There's a couple of proposals from two different organizations, LGC as one and Municipal Resource as the other. Also in this packet you have a copy of the previous job description, and there is also a copy that I'll hand out of a slightly amended description. If you could pass those down, please. It is my hope that counselors will go through this information. If you have specific questions in reference to either one of the consulting firms that are being presented or that put in bids, if you can get me the questions specifically for which one, I will get in touch with them and have them email answers so we've got answers. If you choose to not go with a consultant, we can certainly look at other options. But I know that was part of what I had received from the council when I asked how they wanted to move forward with this. So if you've got questions on that, please get them to me within the next, by the end of the weekend. So if anything, I can contact the firms Monday and hopefully have answers for you for next Wednesday's meeting, because we are meeting next Wednesday to discuss the three warrant articles.
Yes.
And if all goes well, if all the councils are satisfied, next week we can take a vote if we so choose and start moving forward?
Yeah, and you know, if you're not comfortable not talking with the individuals directly, I can attempt to see if they'll be available to come in and discuss their process. I can check and see if they're willing to do that. The same thing with the quote-unquote job description. If you could look at those and any ideas or suggestions, please. That's not as critical, because that's something that we don't necessarily need to get going right away, but we can discuss it as a council at either our next meeting or the workshop. The only other thing that really needs to be discussed is how we want to structure this committee. I can tell you how it was done last time. The last time it was done with a town council member that was either the chair or the vice chair. There was a second town council member. There was a department head, a division head, a police union employee, and there were also three residents at large. Also, in a non-voting position, we used the town administrator from Durham, Todd Selig, as kind of a consultant, and he was very valuable. If you talk to anybody that was on that committee, Councilor Zink, you were on it the last time, I think you'd say that Todd was very valuable in some of the input that he gave us. There's also been suggestions of a system known as LinkedIn, and I'm not quite familiar with that too much, but I guess it's the way to draw applicants in. So that's also a possibility. But I think it's critical to get the committee structure set up, only because the sooner we get the committee set up, the sooner we can get it rolling.
Mr. Chair, are you looking to do that this evening?
The structure, I would certainly like to have it, because if we're going to have X amount of people from the community, you know, as much as I'd like to give them a couple of weeks to get an application in, you know, I would like to get, I'm sure you all would like to get this done. So I'm open for ideas.
I would certainly mimic the last time around. It seems like either the chair or the vice chair and one other council member should be on it. I think, did you say that from the police department was who, Les?
They actually had a police union employee.
I don't know if we need to do that.
I don't see that as
I would think maybe necessity. The chief seer. I would.
He was on. He was actually the division head that was on the last.
Oh, committee. Okay.
But you know, then again, it's up to this council who they want to put. You know, you could go and put two town employees and not make it specific to police or a department head or whatever. You could do that if you wanted to.
Then what's the next part of the process? Then the town employees approach us, or we approach them, or we?
They would have to do what the residents would do, which would be to fill out a form stating their interest in being on this committee.
Okay.
Yes.
I was discussing some of these questions with someone from one of the state agencies, and one of the suggestions they made to me was to maybe have a couple of people not from Newmarket, from some other towns potentially, or other areas, and essentially I was kind of surprised at that initially, but they told me that when they sought people for their agency, they went with people that they dealt with. For example, HHS deals with a lot of different providers, same with DOT and some other ones, and essentially they get a little bit more objective viewpoint when it's not all from within the same community. So I thought I would just mention that because it might be helpful. Just a thought.
Councilor Zink?
I agree with your first statement. I think clearly the chair or the vice chair needs to be there. I think a counselor should be there as well. Having gone through it last time, Todd Selig from Durham was extremely helpful to us in terms of not only understanding what a town administrator does, roles and responsibilities, but he was also pretty networked into the community, which was helpful to us. I would also say that I think it's important on a search committee, whether you have a consultant or you don't, to have somebody that's used to doing it, because it's not it's not good to have, in my experience, all first-timers in terms of looking at candidates. It's nice to have people in the profession that have looked at it, and I can, without misspeaking, I hope, I can tell you the last time that Arlen Chaffee was on it, who does executive search. His background was very, very helpful. I don't know if he's willing to do it or wants to do it, but it was a real boon to the process to have somebody who's familiar with orchestrating search activity and recruiting activity. I think I agree with you about the police union. I don't think that was particularly helpful. I thought Chief Sia was very helpful. The community members, absolutely. And I'm not sure the more the merrier, but a good representation of citizens, I would think, would make great sense. Well, I don't know the number, whether it's 4, 5, 6. It's a lot of work. People that are going to sign up for this thing are going to spend hours that you won't believe reviewing resumes, interviewing candidates, doing references. So people have to set aside a bit of time to do this. I'll bet it's a 50-hour process by the time you get through it. So those are just my general comments. I think a consultant would be helpful to us, perhaps. I'm not sure that either one of these are the right ones, because I think these are people that have self-identified. I don't know if people in the audience, citizens, have ideas of, actually, I did get an email today from a citizen suggesting another source that had been used by another town. So I would say anybody else that has any interest, has any experience in dealing with consultants who do this, I would think the council would want to entertain their presence if we're going to meet them next week or whatever you suggested, to make sure we get a really good, solid representation. Thank you.
I kind of drew up a list of what I personally would like to see. I'd say the chair of the town council, a random member who would volunteer or be chosen by the town council. So there'd be two people from town council. Chief Sear, who I respect his opinion immensely. Becky Benavudi, who I also respect immensely for her knowledge and knowledge of Newmarket and how it works. Two public at large, and Mr. Todd Seligman from Durham, the town administrator of Durham. I think that would be seven people. It's an odd number, and it has a good mix. My 2 cents.
I would agree with that, but I would add two more members at large.
That'd be nine people.
Well, just for the record, Mr. Selig was not a voting member of the last committee. So if you know.
Well, if you could do three at large, then that would, and then he'd make him a non-voting.
So you're in essence, you're replacing, your suggestion is to replace a police union employee with someone like Ms. Benvenuti.
Yes, specifically.
Yes.
Yeah, I was gonna suggest that as a vice chair that I not serve on it. For one simple reason, my term is up in March. If this goes quickly, it may be done, but I may not be sitting here. I may not run, I may not get reelected if I do run. So I don't think it's appropriate for somebody to be in the process that may, you know, change roles in the middle of it. So I concur with Councilor Bergeron's, and I would have a caveat that if we get five applications from people from the public, and I think if we went to no bigger than nine people, I don't think you want to go to a committee much bigger than that. Excuse me, but if we had five members from the public who wanted to serve on it, I would have no problem with that. Much like the dam committee, we could always make it bigger. Right.
Yeah, no, I agree. I should caution you that Chief Sear and Ms. Benvenuti are probably saying, why are you volunteering me for this? Because
and Todd Selleck.
And Todd, yes, because, you know, they have not been spoken to at this point. So I think it's a little premature to suggest that they're going to be willing to do this. I mean, their schedules may not allow it. That I don't know. I would certainly, if the council wanted me to, I would approach the two of them and see if they were interested. But, you know, and I agree with the makeup. If we run into the situation like we did this evening, I think it was a great gesture to increase the size of the committee by one member, because you don't want to turn people down that want to help.
Can I say one more thing? One other thing that I guess Councilor Levy brought up is outside people. You know, it's a fine line. Living in Newmarket, you know, I think the people of town want to keep control over who makes the decisions and who works here. But in this case, I think it would be probably a good idea to have one or two people from out of town. And if we have Todd Selleck, if he's willing to serve, you know, I see no reason why he can't be a voting member. You know, they're not going to be a majority of the committee. Sometimes people outside of the community without any preconceived notions may bring a fresh idea to it, a fresh look at it.
I should also point out, just for the record, that basically the committee whittles it down to like two or three candidates, and then it's presented to the council. So it's the council that does the actual voting on the final person. Just so everybody knows, because that wasn't discussed. It's not like this committee is going to, in fact, hire the next town administrator. So, yes.
I was just going to say that I like the idea of bringing external individuals in. I'm not quite as sure, even though the council is the one that does the ultimate voting, not quite as sure about having them as advisory or voting members. I think I'd be more comfortable with them as advisory members, and that way we don't have to worry about even or odd with them either. Just bring in maybe a couple people from the external. But I certainly think having another viewpoint is great, but I wouldn't want to give up the authority out to people who aren't going to have to live under the administrator of the town.
The rain.
No, I wouldn't say rain, but
I will say Mr. Selleck was very, very good, and he, you know, did not feel slighted because he didn't have a vote. Council Levy?
Yeah, I wasn't going to do it, but I just like to get on the record. You know, I wasn't really necessarily in favor of setting up a committee, but it looks as though that's the direction we're going. So I just want to say this. I would be careful not to have the same players involved as we did in the past. The council has already been accused, excuse me, of employing an old boys network or club by members of the public at one of our last meetings. There seems to be the same people placed on these committees, whether as members of the NCDC with Black Bear TIF or whatever else. And I think whatever we do, it might be nice to get some new faces instead of just the same people over and over again that make these decisions. So I'll leave it at that.
Councilor Bentley, did you have something?
Well, I thought whether, you know, and it's a good point in that. Spoken to Ms. Benvenuti or Mr. Sear, but if we could pin down, exactly right now, because I think we all want to get this process going. So if we said two town employees, and they can all put in, and then we could vote, make recommendations and vote, and then the two council members, one of which I certainly agree with Mr. Bodeman's, with Vice Chair Bodeman's, you know, that he had enough foresight to say he shouldn't be involved because he doesn't know if he'll run or not. And, you know, that's probably a good point. So if we could say two town employees, two council people, and then the you know, Let's pin it down. Is it five citizens at large, or is it three? Is it one outsider or two outsiders? I mean, we're hearing from a couple of people that it worked real well having the administrator from Durham. You know, is that something we could pursue now? Could we make a call to him again? Is he available again? Would he do it again?
Certainly.
At least if we can leave here tonight saying, these are the, we want 10, and it's these 10 people. And then we can, you know, get it out to the town employees and get it out to the citizens and let them start putting in, you know, get it up on the marquee and get this process going, because nothing else will start until the committee's there, really. So if we can just pin that down, I think we have it. I think we're right there. It's how many outside people, how many town people.
Okay. I'm sorry.
So as much as I want to say what Councilor Levy said, I think it would be good to have new blood. I mean, it's always good to have new blood to be out looking for individuals. But the way I'm looking at this is that if we had the list that we're talking about right now, even with the town employees in here that we're talking about, that's potentially five new people. So it would be the voting majority by far on this committee who would be new people. I don't think we should just, personally, I don't think we should leave it up to say any town employee that wants to. I like the idea of like self-selection, but especially with the community members, but for town employees, I think if we chose chiefs here and Becky, I think there's very particular reasons why those are the individuals we'd be choosing. And I think as opposed to letting it be catch-as-catch-can for who volunteers, I think we should go out and reach out to individuals that we think probably are the ones that are best suited for this particular search.
I meant for the purpose of this evening, we could say two town employees to be determined, just so we can walk out of here tonight and say it's going to be two town employees. And then we approach those, you know, because Chief Sear could say, I'm already, no way, I'm checked out.
I mean, I'd like to walk out tonight saying two town employees.
I agree.
These two are the ones we're going to ask.
Yeah. Well, I think I have no problem with that.
Councilor Bergeron?
As far as outsiders are concerned, when you say outsider, I mean, what are we talking? A professional headhunter? Are you talking about a consultant? Are you talking about just somebody who lives around Newmarket? I mean, I'm a little uncomfortable with it because this town has, in this area, has unique problems, and, you know, be it the bay or the tax rate or whatever it may be, I want somebody who has a little bit of flavor of what's going on around here too. I mean, I'm really not quite sure where, Mr. Levy, if you could explain to me. A specific example would be?
Yeah, well, for example, I don't want to mention the person, but one of the agencies that I discussed this with told me that they actually had someone with whom they did business, someone that was not, someone that was, I don't want to say an adversary, but that they did business with, and sometimes they had, you know, confrontations or disputes and things of that nature, and they wanted to have, and I said, why would you have that person? And they said, because they have to work with them. And I was kind of surprised. You know, I was taken aback. I was like, why would you want to have someone that, you know, you do business with that can be adversarial and or have their own interests in mind? And they said, because that's how you get, that's how you don't get a bunch of yes people, and you get people that bring different viewpoints to the table. And I'm by no means saying it should be a majority, but if it's going to be the same people, whether they're at large or not, that are always involved in the town and that are, you know, work on the same committees, et cetera, I don't know that the last time it worked out all that well. I don't know.
So I agree that we need to make a good decision on this. And I understand that maybe perhaps an outside decision would be a good idea, but how would you go about finding somebody like that? And would they seek compensation for their time?
No, I mean, that would not be a compensation. And if you give me a day, I can, or maybe at our next meeting, I can give you some tangible examples. I'd rather not do it.
I feel more comfortable. I knew that because
ad hoc.
Time is of the essence. And I mean, if we can just put out an all-points bulletin for anybody that's interested in helping us hire a town administrator, I don't know anybody would probably want to take the time, but if there's somebody out there, then I'd be interested to know who they are. But we don't have a lot of time either.
I will try to get you something tangible. I didn't think of it in those terms, but I'd be happy to do that. you know. In this case, it was a provider for an agency that they brought in that was not necessarily a friend or a foe, but it was someone that they dealt with on a consistent basis. And, you know, they told me that's how they do it. This isn't a new concept. That's how the state, you know, does a lot of their hiring when they bring in a new commissioner. This was over a commissioner, by the way. So, anyway.
And I was thinking more on the lines of additional people like Todd Selig, you know, whether the town manager, town administrator in Exeter would be willing, or Stratum, or somebody has the time, and they, I mean, it's a field where they all, a lot of the people, they obviously know each other, mm-hmm. and that can help weed through a lot of garbage.
Well, if the council would like, I will attempt to contact Todd tomorrow, Becky tomorrow. Todd is probably the more reasonable one, only because he is like next door neighbor, and I know he was on the last time, but Becky was not. Councilor Zink.
I should probably let this pass, but I'm not gonna. And that is that. The discussion about the people that have served on other committees, and it's the same people that serve on committees that keep coming up. I think number one, it's a slap in the face to those who continually volunteer for the town, and I take huge exception to that. Huge exception to the committees that were named as well. I would agree, however, that if we had a large field of candidates, which we never do, that are willing to put in these kinds of hours, which most aren't, that I've never seen, at least on my activities on the Budget Committee and Search Committee and Town Council, good qualified new candidates turned down for the quote-unquote good old boys. And I would hope that as we put out announcements for people to join us, that there would be a ton of new people, so that those that volunteer for everything all the time don't have to volunteer for everything all the time. And I just can't let that pass. So I hope I'm wrong. I hope that when we put out, we're looking for how many citizens? We haven't decided yet.
Three
or five?
Initially.
I hope there are 20 that apply, that are willing, that have the expertise and are willing to put in the time to do it.
Geez, I would volunteer. I'd be happy to volunteer. I don't think I've ever been chosen for that stuff. I'd be happy to volunteer.
We're talking about at large.
You know.
I wasn't referring to.
Well, I think, you know, I sort of think you were, but that's okay.
Well,
but,
excuse me, I was not. I was making a statement about citizen volunteers. And I'd appreciate the ability to make that station with that statement without criticism from you.
You may.
Thank you.
I think if I can just if I may, Mr. Chairman, a couple weeks back, it was brought up about people jumping from committee to committee, and I understand what Councilor Zink is saying, And I was pretty taken back with it because, number one, Councilor Nazaro's first time on was this year. I was just barely at my year anniversary, and Councilor Levy was brand new. And I thought it was kind of funny. They said just jump from committee to committee. And also, talking to townspeople since that comment, a lot of people didn't know that every councilor has to be on one committee. So just so the public knows, if you see us here and then see us on a budget committee, or see us here, then on a planning board, or see us here and then see us on the Energy Commission, each one of us has to be on a committee. So it might seem like you see us a lot or the same people, but I understand Councilor Zink's frustration and attention to that. So anyway, it doesn't get us this finished. I was hoping we could leave tonight knowing the exact makeup, and I think it's the outside of town at large people. When I'd spoken about it, I thought we spoke about the town administrator worked well last time, having the Durham town administrator, and
I would certainly support that again, whether he could do it or Exeter could do it or some other one nearby that we have a good relationship with would be willing to do it, I think. But I really think we need to wrap up a number and then get going forward, or, you know, we wait another week for the next meeting, or we try to do it, you know, is it three or is it five residents? Is it, you know, I think we have the two town people, I think we have the two councilors, and is it three or is it five at large from the town, and then is it one outsider, and is it an administrator, or is it an administrator from another town plus another outsider, or I think time is of the essence. One of the things we got here said the normal search can be 90 to 120 days. You know, we need to get rolling here and make this happen.
To wrap it up, we say that we're going to have two councilors to be voted on by the council. I don't...
Is that a motion?
Yeah, I'll make that a motion.
Okay.
First part of it. Second, there will be two town employees with...
To be selected by the council.
To be selected by the council, but with the understanding that we will ask Chief Sear and Becky Benvenuti first. So that's four. Three members from the public. Todd Selig as a non-voting member from Durham, if he will so do so.
And, or his equivalent.
Or his equivalent.
All right.
And
a consulting firm.
And a consulting firm or two, or outsider, if you will. How are we to define that? Yeah.
A consultant. You know, I mean, if we agree that we want to go, you know, the two that I've given you, obviously there's money involved. So I guess we can leave that part of it open for discussion next week, because you don't really want to commit to getting a consultant in until you've had a chance to talk with the right. two of them.
Right. And Councilor Levy was going to, I think he's going to get a name or two of people. I think having somebody from the outside is not a bad thing, you know. And for the sake of discussion now, if we approve that, much like the dam thing, if mm-hmm. next week we get flooded with 25 applications from people in the public and, you know, there's four town administrators from towns by that want to help, we can change the makeup.
So that's your motion.
That's my motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion. Councilor Zink.
I'd just like to make a friendly amendment that we expand the members of the public from three to five.
It's fine with me.
And if we can't fill them, we'll reduce it. But I'd rather operate okay under the expectation we're going to have a lot.
Agree, because someone's going to be missing or other commitments or...
Okay, any other discussion? All right, just so that we've got this, so I've got this straight. Two council members, two town employees, you're requesting that I check with Chief Sear and Ms. Benvenuti, correct?
That's the motion, yep.
Five members at large, one individual of similar to Todd Selig if he's unable to do it, and potentially at this point we're looking at a consultant, which actually the consultant and the Todd or someone would not be voting members of that committee. Would you keep it that? Would you want them to vote or no?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Going back to Council Levy's point, well, I guess I don't think it's a terribly bad idea if there's somebody on the outside to be interested in participating in this too. I think the concept is a good one. I don't know how we solicit people, but I'd like to leave that open if there is a non-member of the public. I'd like to add that as a possibility.
It was my intention that last one, the consultant was a consultant slash outsider.
Oh, okay.
Do you want
that? I thought
you
were talking about
one position or two.
One.
Consultant or?
Mr. Chair.
No, not a paid person, Gary.
the consultant would be, if we were to go with one of these that I presented to you this evening.
Oh, you're talking about...
Would they really be on the committee, or would they actually just be serving?
They're not on the committee.
Yeah, they're just...
Yeah, they're just servicing, I think they're the coordination.
They're coordinating, not...
Yeah, not the person. So change that consultant to outsider.
One outsider.
That was my intent, was that it was an outsider.
Non-vote?
I don't care whether they vote or not, I guess we'll leave it up to everybody else. No, non-voting?
I think, he would give it, I wouldn't.
I don't care.
I don't know as if you know...
You make it a vote.
I'm for making a vote, because I don't know as if we get somebody that's going to spend a lot of time and energy on something they can't vote on.
There you go.
I mean, that's...
Yeah, no.
In the middle of this, before we vote, can I make a motion, we stay here after 10, because it's...
Second.
Can you have two motions on the floor?
Right, we can't. Let's clear up this first motion, I think we're close. Let me read it back. Two councilors, two town employees, five members at large, one administrator or like position, and one outsider that will have a vote. Is that the motion?
That's the motion.
That's been seconded?
Yes.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, I'll ask for the vote.
Counsel Levy.
Nay.
Counsel Bentley.
Aye.
Counsel Bergeron.
Aye.
Counsel Zink.
Aye.
Counsel Nazaro.
Aye.
Counsel Bodiman.
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch.
Aye, motion carries 6-1. Now, Counsel Bentley, did you want to make a motion?
Make a motion to stay later than 10 o'clock.
Second.
Discussion? Mr. Winawski to vote?
Counsel Levy.
Aye.
Counsel Bentley.
Aye.
Bergeron.
Hesitantly, yes.
Counsel Zink.
Yes.
Counsel Nazaro.
Aye.
Counsel Bodiman.
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch.
Aye, motion carries 7-0. We're almost there, folks. Old business, new business. Anyone have any old business to start with? No old business? Any new business? Yes.
I was asked by the Budget Committee Chairman last night to communicate a few things to the Town Council, which I'd like to do. First of all, the Budget Committee reduced the budget recommended by the council by about $167,000, and added about $4,000, so a net reduction of about $163,000. There was a fair amount of discussion about, within the budget, about the whole expense of processing municipal waste, the cost of recycling, the whole thing. And it was a request of the committee that the council consider reestablishing a committee that used to exist.
Solid waste.
Solid waste. It's becoming expensive, convoluted, difficult to understand, and it was a recommendation. Their other recommendation was that the Town Council strongly consider, I think was the right term, the use of longevity pay as part of employees' pay, base pay. They also asked the Town Council if they would consider eliminating three of the capital improvement funds and returning those revenues to, I believe, returning those revenues to the general fund. And one, Ed, you're going to have to help me here, was the aquifer...
Protection?
The what?
Aquifer protection?
Aquifer protection, CIP, which I think was about, you gave me the notes and I lost them yet. Anyway, about $40,000. The waterfront improvement, which is, I can't remember how much.
About $29,000.
$29,000. And the community recreation fund, which is the Pines...
Correct.
Which I believe we determined could not be eliminated because... it's an endowment or a trust or something like that.
See how it was established, because if it's a trust, then, and because all you can do at this point is just to expend the interest on it. So okay. We need to see how that was structured.
And lastly, the a comment made to me by a budget committee member following the budget committee, I thought was worthwhile passing along, and that is it relates to the town and the school getting together to prioritize warrant articles. That the individual, we actually, the town and the school had a meeting about warrant articles, but we didn't get to the point where we actually sat down and tried to prioritize them. And I thought it was a pretty good suggestion, so that as voters see our combined strategy on long-term expenses, so I pass that on to the council as a consideration. And that's it.
In reference to the request on the capital reserve funds, I know there's going to be other funds in there with, you know, a lot less balance, like the revolving fund that we had for the what ended up being a revolving fund for the ambulance. There's still some money left in that account. It's small, but maybe this would be the time to get them all set up as warrant articles so we can
get rid of
them, clean them up, and just
I'll pull them for next week and
yeah,
we can look at it.
Yeah, because I mean, it's all money that's coming back, so it's not, you know, it's a warrant article to in essence pull the money out of this
right.
The capital reserve and put it into general fund or whatever it would be. So I would certainly like to see all of those if we could have them for next
we'll
Wednesday and discuss them at the same time as the other articles. Any other new business? Councilor Nazaro?
Yeah, I was asked a question, so, and I don't think we're going to get the answer tonight because Public Works Director isn't here, but is there a criteria for how much snow is how much snow brings out plowing, like sidewalks? Not necessarily. I know that there's no criteria, it's all discretion that.
Go ahead.
So I got a phone call about this too. I think it's the same thing. I was told, and you know, obviously I haven't verified, but I was told that the sidewalks were not plowed, they were salted. But I've worked in DPWs for a long time. There is no criteria. But if you have a half an inch of snow, you damn well better get out and sand and salt the sidewalks, because if somebody falls, you will get sued. If you don't have a requirement to have sidewalks, but if you have them, you have a requirement to keep them safe and clean. So I don't know what happened in that particular instance, but we have to get out and do the sidewalks if there's snow on them.
I can verify your answer because I had heard the same comments, and I contacted Mr. Malasky. It was during the holiday, so he didn't get back to work till like Tuesday or Wednesday, but I did contact him, and they did not plow. They did sand and salt the sidewalks mainly and the intersections.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Can I bring up an issue?
Are we still on new business?
Oh, no, I think it's new business.
Okay.
Are you on new business, old business?
Well, old, new.
This is, I guess, old, new. Several months ago, we had a site distance study done for Autumn Way, and I think it's Autumn Way. Fox Hollow. And you know, there were some recommendations made, and I think we had asked the town planner to send a letter off to the consulting engineers, our review engineer, the engineer, the designer, and the developer. Has that letter gone out?
Yes.
And if so, have we received anything? I know that we did some clearing because the lady
right.
across the street allowed us to do that.
Yep.
I thought we were going to the residents in that area, not to the, I thought that was the request, was to check and see if the residents were satisfied with the site distance that they were getting.
No. We're looking at it in one direction, but the other issue was relative to cutting down the knoll and whether the developer was in a position to be able to do that. I know the letter was sent, but I haven't heard back, but I will get an answer. I'll have a discussion with Ms. Hardy about that.
And the reason I asked is I went to Epping, I don't know, one day over the weekend, and I stopped in there, and it certainly is a lot better than it was, mm-hmm. but I still don't think it meets criteria. So, you know, rather than have the town next year, the year after, be forced to spend money to do it, if we can force the developer to do it, it would be better off.
What's that? Under new business, I just want to make sure that, Mr. Winowski, you'll have up on Channel 13 the advertisement for the members at large for the
yes.
search committee
yep.
On the board out front, on the web page also. And just to make sure, I would like, if I know it's short notice, but if we do have any applicants by next Wednesday's meeting, we'll certainly discuss them. And we need to fill it with some more people. We'll ask for more people to sign up. So, okay.
Yep.
Yes.
When should, I think that's a great question, when should applicants have, if they do want to be considered, it is a decision that's going to be made next week?
If we've got applicants, I would like to see the council move forward with it, yes. And appoint some.
So people need to get their application in
yeah.
real quick.
If we get two, you know, we'll.
For next week?
Yes. Unless you want to draw it longer, I mean, you know, I'm.
Trying to figure, okay.
I don't think we can wait longer, my own personal opinion. I think we need to get the people on in.
See what kind of response.
See what we get. I mean, yeah. we may not get them.
And if we, you know, if we don't get enough to fill it, that doesn't mean that the openings will disappear. They'll still be there, and we'll deal with it the following week and the week after.
So those individuals that apply by next week will be selected?
Well, they will be
considered.
Considered, yes.
Ahead
yes.
of any others.
Don't
okay.
we meet in 2 weeks?
No, sir. We meet next okay. Wednesday for warrant articles.
And not the next week? We don't meet.
No, we're going to meet that week, too.
Right? Yeah.
It's a full-time job.
And under new business, I think you may have all received a notice from Ms. Benvenuti in reference to the vote next week. Councilors are expected to be at the polling place for 8 o'clock to help count and sort and do all that fun stuff that we do. So if you're not going to be able to make it, please contact me and let me know.
Do we have a workshop on the 18th? Am I missing something?
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
Oh.
But we
well, if we have, why wouldn't we do the members, why wouldn't we give them
2 weeks to get in applications? I mean, I don't know.
We may end up with 2 weeks, Gary, but I think we're trying to get it rolling as fast as we can.
Yeah, I can see that.
I mean,
thank you.
That's great.
Can I bring up?
Yes.
Something. I know we talked about this earlier tonight, but I guess I just want to clarify it. With the roughly $400,000 shortfall in revenue, we're going to obviously need to look at spending for the rest of the year that we talked about. Is the plan for the next meeting, is it the plan for the town administrator to come to us with some proposed savings where you think we can make the savings?
Yes.
And then also in the meantime, councilors, if you have your budget books still, you can look through them and see.
Don't forget you're talking this budget, the budget.
No, right. I understand, but. If you look through this year's budget, it's relatively the same as last year's budget. You know, the same. It's less, but
they have started the process.
You know,
and I'll let Mr. Winowski explain where they're at currently. Just in, but it'll improve, I'm sure.
Correct. What I did immediately after receiving the email from Matt Angel, email to all the department heads, and I indicated to them that I wanted them to begin. Scrutinizing and cutting back on large purchases and to the extent possible they look at various items that they have that they don't have to make any expenditures on right now as it relates to overtime and public works and the purchase of salt and sand as being just two items. I also asked them to look at heating oil and propane, those types of things, and we'll be talking about a lot more at the department meeting tomorrow. Matt Angel and I sat down today and we began going through the budget and started to identify areas that as it relates to wages that we are saving and benefits that we can identify that. And what we will do is come to the council at the council's business meeting, workshop, with a resolution as to having the council freeze certain dollars so they cannot be expended, and continue to identify $4,037,000 that we can make up the shortfall. But we're also going to be looking at revenues, because there are some areas there that, as Matt has pointed out, we don't seem to have a very firm handle on it. And over the next couple of weeks, working with departments, he's going to begin to develop a six-month cash flow as it relates to revenues and expenditures, so that we can watch that a lot more carefully. So by the meeting on the 18th, if that's when we meet again, for the workshop, we will have a overview of that and a resolution.
Okay, thank you.
Just for my edification, this is the report here. Would this apply to this year?
That's the budget for this year, yes.
Yeah, so if we could find $400,000 in this, that would help you?
It won't help me, it'll help
the
community.
Help this. It'll probably help you, too.
Yeah, I mean, I personally think that, you know, I would like to think that we're not going to find a lot of savings in fuel and
correct.
Oil, because I like to think we're not wasting a lot of money in those areas now. I think we're going to have to look at areas like, you know, DPW, part-time
true.
Help, things like that. I don't see where we're going to save it. I mean, and we may save it in salt, but I tell you what, I'll be the first one if Rick Malasky tries to save money by not buying salt, and we have a big storm and there's no salt and the roads are a mess, I'm going to be all over them. You know, that's
very
dangerous.
And that's not what I'm
okay.
saying.
Okay. Thank you.
And I think you also need to realize that we have currently two positions that were funded for the fiscal year that are not filled at this point, and will not be filled, probably will not be filled.
Four.
I guess that's the best. Well, but there's two. What do you get four?
I have the foreman in DPW. I have the
mechanic.
We have the position of human resource that's okay. vacant for 6 months, and we have benefits that we're saving, at least in the finance director's position.
Okay. So three and a half.
Yeah.
Okay. So there is some. And also the revenue stream, Matt seems to think might be a little bit better on the one, some of them we didn't
correct.
Forecast at all.
Right. And that's what we're, that's what we.
So that's why it's 2 weeks, we should have a better picture of it.
Yep.
Any other old new business? If there's not, Mr. Winoski, you still have your report. I believe you had a short one.
I'll make it short.
Report.
The first thing I want to do is bring up the fact that the Great Bay Half Marathon will be run on Saturday, April 17th, which is a departure from past years, which has been on a Saturday, and the reason being it would have fallen on Easter. Local sports has been working with the police department to solidify all the different pieces of it. The race will begin at 11 o'clock. There will be some minor inconvenience to the post office, but the race, if everyone recalls, begins at the elementary school, comes down, so by the time the runners come into town, will be well after noontime. It's about a two-hour race, 2.5 hours. So traffic downtown will be able to move through the town. There'll be some minor rerouting for it, for the setup and stuff. But if the council is acceptable with that, Arlen Chafee and is working with the police department, and they seem to have a good relationship at this time on the whole project.
Do we need to make a motion on that?
Just to accept the date of April 17th as the date
okay.
of the Great Bay Marathon.
April
7th. 7th. April 7th.
7th? 7th.
I'll
sorry.
Make a motion to accept the date of April 7th for the half marathon, contingent upon working out the details with Chief Sear.
Second.
Any discussion?
Is there any cost to the town? Just out of curiosity, for my own edification.
No. Basically, the police is paid for by the event organizers, and it tends to be a fairly beneficial opportunity for not only showcasing the community, but to the businesses downtown.
I think everything else is volunteers.
Yep.
A lot of volunteers.
Parkers, lot managers.
Yep.
Is it not, is there any profit in it, or is there, I mean, is there any cost, is there any profit made on it?
I do know that they tend to go after local organizations to help out, and they do donate some funds to, I know in the past they were doing Club Chameleon. They were utilizing them, and they were giving them some money for their stuff. I think the senior class, parents from the senior class go and volunteer, and they'd make a donation
project
to this
graduation.
Project graduation. So there is money that goes back into the community, obviously.
Is there, Arlen, what's the fee for running in the race? Is there a...
Looks like Eric's going to run it this year, finally.
I'm gearing up. Getting the motor on the couch.
It varies whether it's 5K or the half marathon, okay. But it's like $55 to run in the half marathon, I believe, $25 to run in the 5K. And the last 2 years, we've gone for a DOT parade permit and put in the traditional detour around town. That way we close off downtown Main Street, and the run finishes downtown. We'll have 2,000 runners this year and easily that many spectators, so 4,000 or 5,000 people in town for the day, and merchants love it.
And you have the health fair before?
We won't this year because it's a Saturday. Right, but every other year, yeah, we take the high school and we do a health and wellness expo on Saturday and run the race on Sunday. It's just the way the calendar falls. It's once every 7 years, and we don't anticipate having the conflict 7 years from now. This is the sixth annual running of the race.
So it's $55, or what was it again? What?
$55 to run in the half marathon.
Is this a half marathon or?
A half marathon and a 5K.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we partner with Exeter Health Resources, the hospital, and they help pull together the Health and Wellness Expo on Saturdays when we're doing it. This year we won't be doing it, but the 5K beneficiaries, the Beyond the Rainbow Fund.
I will be available to carb load afterwards.
Okay. Thank you.
Does a percentage of that go back to the community, Arlen? What kind of percentage goes back?
The way we do it with the community is volunteer organizations. We make contributions to Project Graduation, to Club Chameleon when they were operable, cross-country team, et cetera. We'll hire them to do water stops, et cetera. But
local sports. Do you set aside a certain percentage?
No, we do not. Local sports owns the event and operates it.
Okay. So it is for-profit?
Local is a for-profit entity, yep.
And you pay, I think my experience with, like, Project Graduation, you pay X amount per volunteer.
Yeah, we contribute. I don't have the figures in front of me, but we contribute on the order of $2,500 a year to that. We've contributed to athletic scholarships. To Club Chameleon. We've paid for their Hershey track and field when they fielded teams there. We put them in uniforms for the middle school cross-country team, et cetera. We live here in town, so we try to give back when we can. But it's been a great experience, so.
Okay, there's a motion and a second on it, I believe. So, Ms. Winowski, will you call the vote?
Council Levy?
Yes.
Council Bentley?
Aye.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council Zink?
Aye.
Council Nazaro?
Aye.
Council Bodeman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 7-0. Ms. Winowski?
I just want to run over some of the important dates we have coming up. Tuesday, January 10th at 5 o'clock is the last day to submit any budgetary petition warrant articles to the town clerk. Wednesday, January 11th at 7 p.m. is the town council's public hearing on bond warrant articles, and it'll be in chambers. Tuesday, January 17th at 7 p.m., the Budget Committee will hold a public hearing on both the town and the school budgets that evening. And that event will be here at the in the auditorium. On Tuesday, February 7th at 7 p.m. is the deliberative session. We'll be here in the auditorium for that's for the town budget. And on Tuesday, March 13th is the town meeting. Voting will be for the voting on the town and school budgets and the election of officers from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. here in the auditorium. Those who might be interested in running for any public offices, the filing period begins on Wednesday, January 25th, closes on Friday, February 3rd. The town clerk's office will be open on the 3rd from 3 to 5 to accept anybody's papers that wish to file. The presidential primary is Tuesday, January 10th, next week. Voting is at the high school gymnasium. The polls will be open from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. And Chair has already noted about the request for members of the council to be present at the counting.
We have one question.
Can I ask a question about the process?
Sure.
Next Tuesday is voting, and next Tuesday is the last day for warrant articles. Becky is going to, I assume, going to be at the high school all day having to deal with the voting, yet they only have till 5 o'clock to hand warrant articles.
The 10th is set by state law.
That's fine, but I just think we need to talk with Becky, because my understanding of the warrant articles is that she will read them, make a determination in her opinion whether they're legally binding and accept them, right?
She won't make that because she has to count the number of
signatures and everything.
Right.
But I just want to make sure that if somebody has a warrant article, they don't go to the clerk's office have somebody there say,
I'm not
the town clerk, I can't take it.
We'll discuss that.
We need to make sure that that's clear.
We'll work it out.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for bringing that up.
But she's going to have to make a determination as to whether or not they're legal.
Correct.
Right.
So that's not going to all
Well, whether they're legal or not, it's not her determination. Her determination is whether or not the individuals who signed the petition are registered voters in the town.
And then she sends them off to
legal counsel to have them review.
Okay.
At that point in time.
I just want to make sure that if anybody has any warrant articles, they're not
squeezed out. Thank you for bringing that up, because we'll discuss that.
Okay.
She and I will have a discussion tomorrow. And that is all I have.
Okay. Next meeting is next Wednesday. We're going to be discussing warrant articles. So we'll be meeting upstairs at 7. We still have a workshop on the 18th. I need to know if the council wants to go into non-public to approve minutes this evening, or if you want to do it next week due to the hour. Up to the council. Is that a motion?
I'd like to make a motion. We do it next week due to the hour.
Second.
Discussion?
I will not be present next week. I'm on business.
Okay. Thank you for telling me that.
Well, we should all be here. What about the 18th?
Yep. 18th. Everybody good?
Yes.
Can we amend that to the 18th? You're not going to be here.
If we have a non-public at 6, I can be here on the 18th. I've got to be in a meeting in Salisbury at 7. Or we could do. Or if we did it afterwards, I could be back here by 8:30 or 9 o'clock, so I can do it afterwards.
We can do it afterwards.
Do it after. Okay.
Okay.
All right. I'll be there.
So can we amend it to the 18th?
Sure.
Yes.
Make friendly amendments.
The second on that is good still. Okay. Any discussion? Seeing none, Mr. Winowski, will you call the vote, please?
Aye.
Councilor Bentley? Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor Zink?
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro?
Aye.
Councilor Bodiman?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries 7-0.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Thank you, councilors.